to the talk, which starts off with some general sort of physics stuff to give you an understanding of what the program is all about. And then I want to come to some more specific diagrammatics in higher category theory, which explains some of the technical detail, a small part of the technical detail at the start of the project. So, so firstly, physics. This is about induced gravity, which is a very old discovery from Tapper originally. So if you start with Lorentz signature metric and n fermion fields, and you do some quantum field theory with an energy cutoff C, so C is a maximum energy scale. And I've written down here the standard Dirac Lagrangian here, and the cosmological term. And DC is the Dirac operator, but cut off, so it's cut off at the maximum energy scale. So in order to apply a function to it, which means that the eigenvalues don't go all about infinity, but they sort of bend over and just become constant, some high value. And when you integrate over the matter modes, basically it's just taking determinant of this operator here, and typically what you do is you subtract off the contribution from one to the fixed metric. That's finite, and then you can take this determinant, and when you expand this asymptotically, you get the following formula. Asymptotics here with the Dewitt coefficients. So you get here a change to the cosmological term here, in fact, a very large change, and you also induce here the Einstein-Hilbert action with time some very precise constant here, which depends on the cutoff. And then plus etc. means there's higher order terms in the curvature, which are typically very small standard energies. And in fact, you get the right signs here for the Einstein-Hilbert action. You get a shifted cosmological constant, you put in one to start with, but you get a shift. And this whole idea really makes sense if there's a cutoff. So you need this cutoff. If you try and remove the cutoff, of course, you send these terms to infinity here, and you're not going to accept it. So you're integrating over the fermion field, start here. So you do the fermion function interval, which is a determinant. So the idea is to use this in quantum gravity. You see, when people normally talk about quantum gravity, they normally think of the matter as some sort of extra, some sort of luxury item. So you can quantize gravity on its own if you work hard enough, and then when you finish, perhaps as an exercise, or then added matter afterwards. And the common view is that, well, you can do this, you could, this will just make the thing more complicated, so it's something you might have postponed and leave till the end. But actually, the point of view I want to press here is that adding the matter in perhaps is the first thing one should do in constructing quantum gravity. And it's actually the interaction between matter and gravity that's the important thing, not just the dynamics of the gravity on its own. And that's because of the induced gravity phenomenon that actually you can get the gravitational dynamics out of the matter action. So the spectral action is a particular way of viewing the action for all the fields of nature. So if you add in the realistic gauge fields, Higgs boson, and realistic fermions. You can actually regard this in the same way as I had in the previous transparency, but for a space-time n producted with some non-commutative internal space f. And And when you do the polluter climb implication on this product space here, with the direct operator and thermal field of the product space, and you expand it out to get all the sound, all the gravity, the gauge fields and everything, and even reasonable predictions. So this is a way of booting up the previous model problem into the realistic physics. My proposal here is that the action should just be the thermionic action in the cosmological term, and one shouldn't actually bother with the bosonic term. One should regard that as induced. So now we come to the category of theory of physics. How does that work? Well, I don't want to go into vast amounts of detail here at this stage, but just to say that the whole idea of a state sum model is it's a discrete function integral on a triangulated manifold. So you take a manifold, you chop it up into small pieces. It doesn't actually have to be simplexes, it can be any shape, even topological pieces, simple enough. And the input data here is the gauge group, if you like, in physics terminology or in math terminology, category, and by category I mean some higher category, of course, and that plays the role of the gauge group, which determines the sort of geometry or the sort of field content of your theory. And optionally, you can put in some local observable into the theory, so you can specify particular places, some particular observables of geometry. And then the output of this calculation is a Cartesian function, just like in statistical physics, and you get a complex number. And there are various examples people construct in physics, so particularly 3D quantum gravity is something we can construct this way. There are general examples there. So here's a wish list of properties that you want for your state sum model. If you like, this is a project to find the right sort of spectral model that has all of those properties. Firstly, I want some diffeomorphism invariants, so I want to be able to implement mappings of the underlying spectral manifold. So we have a four manifold, I want to be able to implement those in my theory. So it's diffeomorphism invariant, or in fact, technically, it's not linear invariant in this special setting. And I want the sum that's in this discrete function integral to be interpretable as a sum over geometries. So there'll be many examples of category of input to the model which don't have a good geometric interpretation. So that's no good. I want particular ones that have a geometric interpretation. And we know some. I mean, we know some models where this does work. So it's not all wishful thinking. We want the geometry to be discrete at the Planck scale, so we don't just want the usual continuum disaster where you have no cutoff in the theory. I actually want this energy scale cutoff to actually be part of the construction theory. And that's an important thing for the induced gravity, because you see a discrete geometry at the Planck scale means that if you have matter in the theory, the matter modes will be cut off at the Planck energy, or this cutoff energy C. So of course I need my theory to be able to work out matter couplings. So if I have this theory which is a sum over geometries, I need to know what the matter coupling is here and how to implement some matter in this theory. So we need something extra which is normally put into these models. And finally I need a cosmological constant. Now all these things in black we all have in various models. In fact, not all together at once, but we have them in various combinations. They're not an unreasonable list of things. The thing at the bottom here, the blue, that we should have something that goes that looks like the spectral action of the standard model, that's something we don't know how to do. That's very much complete wishful thinking on my part. So maybe one day there'll be something to say about that, if there isn't at the moment. But the important thing to realise that's missing from this list is I haven't said we need to program in the Einstein Hilbert action. So that's what I've spent a lot of my life trying to do, is to work out how these theories can work with the Einstein-Hilbert action built into the category theory, and that seems to be enormously hard to do. You make some various approximations to doing this, but actually doing it in the realistic sense doesn't seem to be possible. In fact, it seems that actually doing this conflicts with having all these other nice things that you want. So I'm changing tack here and saying what we should really be looking for is reasonable matter patterns, and then when we've done that, we hope that the gravity action is induced by a sacrifice mechanism afterwards, and don't have to do any work at all to get that some field action out right.
So, but one way of interpreting it, you could, Einstein Hilbert's action wouldn't be the thermal ultimate invariant, because it depends on the metric. I mean,
yeah, but each configuration of summits is a metric. So one configuration is a different water invariant, but summing over them depends on the So, okay, so now I want to flick through some of this stuff. So the particular construction I want to show in more detail is to talk about this in 3D. So I'm going to cut the space-time dimension down to 3D. There's two reasons for doing this. One is that three dimensions is the first dimension which is reasonably non-trivial, and you can actually sort of feel what you're doing actually has something to do with it. Probably in two dimensions, you can sort of do anything and you don't really notice. It's all too easy. Four dimensions is hard work. The other reason is we also understand the physics of the three-dimensional models very well. So they're connected to the three-dimensional shared science, topological field theory. So we understand sort of physics context. So yeah, so we've been working in this context of physics on Friedman models. And so the idea is that we want to think of the matter, degrees of freedom, if you like, as defects in the state somehow. So I want to explain, at least in the local picture, how you can have a defect in the state of the model. So I want to explain particularly how to draw two cat diagrams. That's diagrams for the three category, the tri-category, two cat. And in fact, to make this realistic, you want duals everywhere. In fact, there's duals at different levels, and there's various dual experts. I can see two, at least two here in the audience, but there's probably more. So I'm not going to talk anything about duals at all, because that just makes the whole thing much more complicated. But there is a dual story, and I'm just not going to go into it. And the particular thing I want to describe is the action of a two-cat diagram. So a two-cat diagram will be some sort of morphism, higher morphism going from category C to D, on the action of such a diagram, on a two-category diagram, which belongs to C. Well, makes sense by the time I've said it on the board. And the interpretation here is that the two-cap diagram, you see, this will specify the defects in the state. That's the matter. And the actual diagram in the given fixed two-category C is a geometry. And so given two such geometries, one can actually stick them together. One uses action of the matter on the first geometry and then take the inner product of the second one. And then that's the partition function of the state model, which I was talking about, connected with the physics. So that's the sort of general context of what I'm trying to do. So I'll now switch to the blackboard and try and draw some pictures. Perhaps convince you that one little part of this project does make some kind of sense. So, spacer model, I'm still sketching a bit here. You have a manifold, and the idea is that given a category or a higher category of some sort, which I'll explain in a minute actually, then from this you can calculate the partition function depending on that category and the manifold N. Whoops. And that's a complex number. And this is done by some local calculation, a bit like a statistical mechanics model. You decorate all the simple x's of all dimensions with objects, morphisms, higher morphisms from the category, and you sum over all such assignments with a suitable weighting factor. So I don't want to describe that in detail, in fact I'll describe a sort of a part of it a little bit later. But this is how I want to think of the matter. So the most elementary matter coupling is when you have, you split this manifold into two pieces. So you think of this as, think of this as our boundary to start with, and now I'm going to cut it across some boundary there into two bits, M1 and M2. Decorate the two halves, this half with category C and this half with category D. Then in between them I want a functor, between the right sort of functor between whatever these categories are. So in fact if my manifolds have dimension N, the categories have got to be A minus 1 categories. So this will be the right sort of functor for those things. And the idea is that I then calculate my partition function with this setup here. I calculate the partition function of the left-handed piece in category C, and I calculate the partition function of the right-handed piece in category D. And I then apply the functor to one of these, namely this one here, just do it schematically here. Now, these are manifolds of boundary. And then, in fact, you have various boundary data here, which is sort of common to the two constructions, or would be if they were in the same category. And so I'm applying the functor to all of that boundary data. And the gluing here of the two together, well, I'm not going to describe it in detail, but just set the data equal and carry on with the function integral. So you get an inner product of those two, and that's in the complex numbers again. So that's my sort of glued up partition function. So in this situation, there's two categories in this function.
Now, where is the Hilbert space living where you're taking this inner product?
Well, I haven't really described it. It's the Hilbert space of the boundary data. But, so this is all very sort of schematic at the moment. But there is a Hilbert space of boundary data. And that boundary data is data from this category C. And I apply the function to it, and I get suitable data in for the boundary data. So you see, in this way, you get some sort of additional thing going on here, topologically, on this boundary surface here between these two pieces. So I can see this up here, you see, and I'll get more precise in a minute, but this is just to motivate. So supposing I now split this surface into two parts, so dramatically like this. So, as before, I've got category C decorating here, category D decorating here. And I want two different functors here. I've got functor F1 on this part, functor F2 on this part here. And they're both functors from category C to D. F1 here, and F2 here. And then, if you can just sort of imagine the boundary data here, which is in category C, gets mapped into category D here with F1, and the boundary data here gets mapped into category D with F2. But there's sort of a gap, because these functors are mapped in sort of different ways. Along here, so it's torn apart in regards to where they end up in the category there. So what you need, in fact, to make it make sense is you attach a natural transformation to that boundary of boundary apart along there. And then with that data there, transformation, you can then calculate even more schematically, an inner product, which is something like sort of, without explaining what excitation means. You can apply that whole thing to one side, and then inner product it with the other side. And now this depends on this what's turning into a sort of a complex embedded inside the manifold here and labelled by these gadgets here. And you can carry on with this game, I'm just going to write acceptable. And you can make, you can start making this thing more complicated, you can put other bits on here, and different functors, another category, curly, E here, and so on. And you can then have higher dimensional stuff and split this in one this two-dimensional surface into pieces and then in higher category things and so on. And it gets more and more complicated.
Does the operator you find F1 F2 act on Z?
I'm going to talk about how this action works. That's what it's about. So that's the general motivation. Now I want to come to the more specific thing. So I'm going to fix to dimension 3, and I'm only going to talk about the local picture. So I'll open in some small region, which will be a ball. So it is my notation, so as I've indicated there, I've got C and D, etc. These are now the two categories. F and G, and so on, will be the right sort of functors, two categories. And they have a composition, which is this box. New, etc. Pseudo natural transformations. Compositions, box and circle. And then the top level are the modifications, and then the capital Greek letters, psi, phi, psi, etc. Modifications. Three compositions there. So now I want to explain what a tricategory diagram is. Now, what's a tricategory? So these things here together form a particular type of tricategory. These form a, in fact, a grey category, I think you'd probably call it. So this is a semi-strict tricategory. As described in Gray's book. Okay, so what I'm going to say it will be particular. I will say it for this example here, but in fact it will work for any great category at all. So tricategory diagrams. So these are now just tangle diagrams in knot theory, which you're probably familiar with. So a diagram, you see, so we want to associate these, as I've indicated in my sort of preamble, to various dimensional surfaces. So in fact, a three-dimensional region the diagram will have a category. Some two-dimensional region, I sort of draw schematically as a plane there, will have pseudo-natural transformations on it. A one-dimensional region will have a functor. Pseudo-natural transformation, and a point in this diagram will be the modifications. So a typical diagram will take place in a cube, which is a representation of the ball, a trivial region. And so I've broken these in different colours here. So just shout if you can't see it. So the way this works is that this will have certain of these. These have been divided up into these regions, stratified, if you like. And on the top and bottom, you'll see nothing except just a category label. So on the bottom, there might be some label C, on the top, D. And on the side, you'll see stripes here, racing stripes, which are the edges of these regions here. Somebody on the sides here. And then on the front and back faces, you'll see the it's the ends of these things. It's a big, might be sort of thing. Something like this. This might come in like this. It's not on there. Oops, no reflecting again. Oops, no. Everyone can stop there, I guess. And these points here will be entirely in the middle of it, so you won't see them on the boundary. But then they'll be a different colour. Then, so that's what you see on the boundary, and then going inside here, these lines will go inside and might meet one of these vertices here, and then carry on to the back face. And this. But it's quite hard to indicate in general what it is. But the idea is you can break this down into elementary diagrams, which I've done precisely. These are the elementary diagrams. So what's the first elementary? First elementary diagram is just to have a single function in it. So if I want a functor, I just have some two-dimensional plane sitting inside there. I'll shape it in. And that's labelled with the functor of interest, so let's label that with my functor F. So that means I have on the bottom here, this region here, category C. So that's just the diagram for functor from C to D. And you can project this diagram by just projecting down from the top. You still project down onto a square in a plane. So this sits in R3 here. So cube in R3. And this is the diagram in R2 now. And you just simply see F, that's all you'll see. It's a very boring diagram. So now let's draw another one. Let's draw the next one. We can go right now. So I'm going to draw some edge here, running from the front face to the back face, and it could in fact have a number of planes meeting at it. There's three planes that meet it on that side, and on this side might be two, so. Then on each of these planes, there is, of course, according to this thing, there is a functor. I'm going to draw them up by the side here. It's F, G, and H. Here, K and L. And then this projection down onto the plane, to a planar diagram, you'll see the following thing. You'll see just that red edge. It's down the middle of the diagram. That's labelled by a certain supernatural transformation U here. So here you'll see the. So what you do is you product. I guess going upwards, excuse my convention here. But you product. So from every point in here, you look at the inverse image under the projection, and you product all the leaves you see up there. So you see here the composition of these functors, F composed G composed H. And here you see K composed L. And that's considered a transformation. So this diagram here told you that it's a transformation from that functor to that functor. That's my diagram. So the next one here has a modification in it. So it would be the centre of the picture somewhere. There's a vertex, one of these blobs here. I'm drawing it in red. There's a modification sitting there. And then there'll be various pseudo-natural transformations, some of them coming out to the front face here, and some of them coming out to the back face. And then in principle, on each of these, you'll see a picture like this going in. You can have two-dimensional planes everywhere in this picture here. And I'm not going to draw that in, so you can have to imagine that. Two cells and draw. Same process that I did here for composing all the functors. So again, you take a point here, you take an inverse image of your line here, and this goes through a number of two cells, and you have to put up two of those functors together. And the result, I'll just draw the result of that. The various functors here. See various here, this very soon natural transformations here in U1 and U2 and so on, and they will be down here. Then you can read off on this diagram, you can read off what everything is. So this new one here has to be a map from F1 to F2, and U2 is from F2 to F3 and so on. And then finally this modification that is in the middle there has to be a map from the relevant things. So fine, to be a map from F1, circle F2, no, bigger one, new one, circle U2, circle new, well, I haven't drawn them all in, actually, U3, whatever it is at the top, U4. That's that diagram. Now, in the grade category, we have one more piece of information, and that's the crossing between non-trivial pseudo-natural transformations. So that has to be a diagram. So let's go with that. So here what I'm going to draw is two different planes at different levels. And by the way, these planes are never vertical. So they're allowed to twist around a bit, but they never go vertical. And that's because I haven't included duals in my formulas. If they go vertical, they fold back on themselves. You need formulas and duals, which I'm not talking about today. So this diagram here, I will have one pseudo-natural transformation going on there, and then the other one, of course, crossing it on that level down there. When I do my projection, square diagram like this, of course, and then you see the right things. Functors here. We have mu goes from F1 to F2, and mu goes from G1 to G2. And of course, you see in the diagram down here, you see picture like this, and then you see. Well, I'll just draw it on them. You see on here, you see here there's a label of mu composed with F1. This region here, for example, is G1, block F1. And again, you can go around the diagram, reading off everything here. You see it's just exactly the right diagram for morphism in the grade category, which intertwines those two pseudo-natural transformations. So, in fact, these diagrams here, now you can compose them. composed in three ways, three compositions. So the dot is vertical in the plane. So that's the normal thing, composing morphisms which you, in the plane, you're used to, you stick them on top of here that way. The circle composition is horizontal. Now, two just means stacking diagrams left to right. In this picture here, of course, stacking the cubes left to right. Here, in this first one here is stacking them back to front. And then the final composition, the grey product here, is what I call stacking. So that means, unfortunately, horizontal and vertical were really used in the two categories as well. So stacking is the third dimension, that means putting the cubes on top of each other. Stacking in three. And then you can make up more and more complicated diagrams like that. And the key thing is you have isotopic invariants. So this is why the whole thing is stuck. So all the axioms of your capping theory just turn into isotopies up here, which turn into relations down there as diagrams, the way you're used to. Okay. So now my final piece of fun is to show you the action. So action. Grey cat diagram. Diagram. So if the grey cat diagram goes from C to D, it has C on the bottom and D on the top, I can act on a diagram in C. So here's my diagram in this grey category. So the functors here, F, G, and H. Two more natural transformations, U, V, and Rho. Modification, Phi. And now I'm going to have a diagram in category C. So supposing all these functors here go from C to D. Now I want a diagram in C, so morphism in category C. So here's my example of this morphism. And I'm going to use a different colour than I guess. Set the rate on that. So what I do is I have objects in C. So these lines here correspond to these unmorphisms in C. And of course here, alpha is a two-morphism. So let's just write this here somewhere. So X, etc. is an object, C naught, C naught. And A, etc. is a one-morphism. And alpha is a two-morphism. So, as you know, for two categories, you can compose that to be a single morphism in the two category. And now here's the action of one or the other. So I draw it big. So basically I just draw one on top of the other. So I'm going to start with the original grey category diagram. So now I want this to be in the category D here. So what did I write in this region here? Well, I take the label that was there, and I apply the functor. No, I take the label that was there, Z, and I apply the functor, and then I run to it. So I have GZ there. And then what's this thing here? Well, so likewise, this thing here, that was an object D, so I can apply the functor to D, so that's G of D. So that is obviously GW there. And just fill in a few more. So I have F of that one more to D there, and so on. And now this supernatural transformation row has component morphisms. So in particular, it has a row sub Z. Write that morphism there, and then this thing here should be row sub W, and then you'll find the right thing to go in there is exactly the component of the supernatural transformation that belongs to the one morphism D. It's the flippy gadget in the supernatural transformation. And similarly, this thing here, this has a component morphism phi sub Z. This has, and so on. You go around the diagram like this. So I'll just draw a bit more of this. And you find that the whole thing matches up in a nice green. So this thing here will be F and alpha. And so on. Well, not enough that you can carry on doing the whole thing there. So what you find is that this thing, let me just write a few buzzwords, you have isotopic invariance here. This is a really nice picture of this. You can move either one of these separately, so you can slide this through that one, and that you really sort of use all the axes. So this red stuff here is the geometry. And this white stuff here is the matter. And you can see one is really interactive with the other because it starts off being like that and then it gets turned into that. This after the interaction. And that's how the two interact. Okay, so I'll stop there.
So, do I understand that you would picture that elementary particles and their trajectories would be connected by a web of higher dimensional things, but they're like transitions between transitions?
Yeah.
Okay. And this has something to do with the curvature.
Yeah, so we already understand, in fact, if you have purely edges, so if you... Right. So if you, in this three-dimensional context, if you take the functor still would be trivial, and you have a suitable category to start with, then the supernatural transformation modifications are within the double of the category. So, and in fact, and so we know if you take 3D gravity, then the double looks like particle motions in 3D gravity. So that's sort of something we know already. So this is a generalization of that.
I see, and you know how to relate this in 4D? Does it relate to the spectral action, or is that just a hope at this point?
That's a hope.
Okay.
But, I mean, I think you can see that you can bring this up to four dimensions with you know, exponentially more work.
What physical situation, if any, does this diagram correspond to? How does this look like?
Well, I mean, so it corresponds to particles moving along these world lines and interactively at these points in the geometry specified by the red stuff.
Okay.
But,
so the lines actually work like the particles?
Yeah. So what the two-dimensional stuff is, I don't know. I mean, I don't have the physical picture for that, but I'm sure people will rush to speculate.
Okay.
Yeah. it's symmetrical.